Hello there, my name is David, and you join me here at one of the meadows that we've got at Merlindale in the Scottish Borders. In this video, you'll learn a little bit about what flowers you might find in a northern hay meadow. Now, why would I tell you about that? Well, we've lost 2.5 million hectares of wildflower meadows since the Second World War, and all of that habitat has gone. And we've lost even more than that of northern hay meadows, which is the type of meadow we've got here at Merlindale. So if you watch this video, I'll tell you a little bit about the flowers you'd expect to see in a northern hay meadow that might be clinging on in the corners of your fields and gardens and may spring back if you relax your mowing or grazing regimes. What better plant to start with when looking at northern hay meadows than the northern hay meadow's signature plant, which is the wood cranesbill. Now, being a member of the cranesbill family, this plant's fruiting body looks a little bit like a cranesbill once the flower is gone, but it also has this attractive array of purple, pink flowers which are held up above the palmate leaves on these thin fronds. You can see here a very delicate arrangement, very attractive, and the leaves themselves are slightly less indented than with some other members of the cranesbill family. Now, the plant itself is good for nesting birds, so you do get small nesting birds nesting in here. It's good for butterflies, it's good for bees, other insects which use the pollen, and in traditional medicine it was used to cure skin complaints and digestive problems with the tannins and things that's present in the plant. And you can see here that this particular one is nestled up against a meadow sweet, being in a slightly damper area of the meadow. Now, here we are with a meadow cranesbill flower, which is slightly different from wood cranesbill. It's got these leaves which are more deeply indented with 5 to 7 lobes, and the flowers are slightly larger and slightly more blue than the purple wood cranesbill. At Merlindale, we've got mostly wood cranesbill, but as you get further down the Tweed, you get more meadow cranesbill mixing in. And something which I found out recently about meadow cranesbill is that it's all around us because it's used in skincare and cosmetics. Ah, now this is another flower that you find in upland hay meadows, and this one's called a melancholy thistle. Melancholy because it used to be used to treat melancholia in days gone by, a type of depression. Now, this is something which also has medicinal properties, anti-inflammatory properties, pain relief properties, and it's a particularly distinctive type of flower. It's got these long single stems with these red-purple florets on the top, which are particularly attractive, and also a very good source of pollen for butterflies and bees, beetles, other forms of insects. It's got these leaves with a sort of white felt underneath, and unlike other thistles, it doesn't have any spines on. And the seed heads provide seeds for linnets and goldfinches, so it's particularly useful for wildlife. It's something that you can see throughout a large part of the summer, so you can see it normally in July and in August, but this year, being very warm, we've got them in flower from the middle of June. Now, here we've got the plant that makes hay meadow restoration possible, the yellow rattle. And it's particularly important since we've lost 2.5 million hectares of wildflower meadows since the 1940s, and 2 out of every 3 remaining ones since the 1980s, that this is something that's done quickly and effectively. And what the yellow rattle does, because it's a hemiparasite, is it enables results that used to take decades to take place in just years. It draws nutrients from the surrounding grasses, and that enables wildflowers to come up through the sward where they wouldn't have done otherwise. The yellow rattle is an attractive plant. It's got these yellow trumpet-shaped flowers and these narrow lanceate leaves. It's liked by bees. You'll see loads of bees on there, lots of beetles and moths, butterflies, but also something I've not read about but seen myself later in the year, in September, when the seeds become hard and rattle in the pods, and that's why it's called yellow rattle, by the way, you'll find ladybirds actually crawl up inside those pods, so you can walk through and see lots of ladybirds throughout September and October. It was a plant that was used in traditional medicines. It was used for curing respiratory diseases, for anxiety and for stress. It's also a plant that's in flower for a long time. It flowers through from June all the way through to September. So for all those reasons, it's an essential part of any native wildflower meadow. Now, can you see nestled in here amongst all of the knapweed and yellow rattle, we've got self-heal, which is a plant that some people confuse with orchids. It looks superficially similar. It's got these two opposing leaves in a double leaf structure going up the stem, and it's got these double-lipped blue-purple flowers. It's a plant which is on the Royal Horticultural Society's list of best pollinators, and it's in the mint family, so it's got a sort of minty taste if you taste the leaves. But what it's best known for is its healing properties. It's got a whole range of healing properties, and it's been used in traditional medicine for hundreds of years for treating wounds, cuts and scrapes and bruises. But it's also got anti-inflammatory, antioxidant properties, whereby it's been used for treating arthritis and that sort of thing. It's been used for digestive problems and overall immune health. So it's a splendid little plant for both pollinators and for people. Now, several people this year have asked me why there are fewer small copper butterflies than there used to be. And one of the answers may be that this plant is less common than it used to be. And this plant is the common sorrel. It's got these green, reddish tinted flowers and these small arrow-shaped leaves. And it's the primary food source for small copper butterflies. Now, these leaves are high in vitamin C, have got a sharp lemony taste, and they're often used in stews and salads. They were used in traditional medicine to cure indigestion and stomach problems. And they're high in antibacterial and antifungal properties, so they're good for overall immune health. Now, the small copper butterfly feeds, having had the egg laid on the underside of the leaf, the caterpillar feeds on the underside of the leaf and creates this sort of transparent look to the leaf when viewed from above. The caterpillar rests in the groove that it feeds on, so it's very distinctive, and goes through two or three generations each year. So you can see these butterflies from May through to October, but in Merlindale we tend to see them from June onwards. Here I am, surrounded by copious quantities of marsh or greater bird's foot trefoil. Now, here at Merlindale, we've got two types of bird's foot trefoil: marsh bird's foot trefoil for the damper areas and common bird's foot trefoil in the drier areas. Bird's foot trefoil, so called because the seed pods look like little bird's feet, has got these yellow, very pretty flowers, and it's very much used by bees and butterflies. It's surrounded by bees at the moment. But something I found out recently is it's an important food plant for caterpillars of the common blue butterfly. And of course, common blue butterflies are becoming increasingly uncommon as time goes on, and perhaps that's because we've got less of this bird's foot trefoil. That's not just good for insects and butterflies. Bird's foot trefoil is also used in traditional medicine for respiratory problems and skin problems and digestive issues. So more bird's foot trefoil will be good for everyone. Now, nestled in down here is Pignut. I don't know if you can see, it's a sort of browny, black and brown shape now because it's flowered. It's got these black seed heads which are liked by siskins and goldfinches. But had we been here a couple of months ago, maybe June, May, we're here in the end of July, then the pignut would be in flower. And it produces these umbels or umbellifer shaped clusters of pink and white flowers, which are much liked by butterflies and bees, all sorts of pollinators. But the pignut in particular is the host plant for several species of moth, including the chimney sweeper. And so if we'd been here at that time, we'd have seen a whole host of chimney sweepers coming off the pignut. Pignut is also an interesting plant because it's the subject of current scientific research, which indicates that it may be useful in treating various types of cancer and diabetes. But as with so many of these wildflowers, as soon as the meadow is ploughed or fertilised, then pignut is lost. Now, here I am in what we call at Merlindale the River Meadow Strip, because it's down a strip along by the River Tweed. I'm here with some red clover, which is sometimes called bee bread or meadow honeysuckle, because it's got a distinctive honey aroma, and it's often covered in bees. It's got these red-purple flowers, egg-shaped flowers, and these trifoliate distinctive leaves, which have got a white marking, a V-shaped marking on them. It was used in traditional medicines for relieving osteoporosis, for reducing cholesterol, so for heart health, for relieving symptoms of the menopause, for general immune health. It's also a good plant for putting nutrients back into the soil and for boosting beneficial microorganisms. And farmers like it too because it's high in vitamins and minerals, it's high in protein, so it's very good for animals to eat. Now, this is common knapweed, and it is a signature plant in typical hay meadows, which are called common knapweed crested dogtail meadows. They're sometimes called bluets. They're also called black knapweed. They've got these distinctive red-purple flower heads, which are actually made up of lots of little florets, which are tiny flowers. And they've got these deeply divided lanceolate leaves, which go down the stem in an alternate pattern. It's a very important plant for pollinators because studies have shown that it's visited by more pollinators and more different types of pollinators than any other flower. And indeed, you can see any number of bees and butterflies on this plant, depending when you look. You can see small tortoiseshells, meadow browns, ringlets, you name it, they visit this plant. Now, it was used in traditional medicine for skin complaints, and it was made into a salve for putting on the skin. It was also used and is used for herbal teas and tinctures. Now, Simon Barnes is the nature writer for The Times. He's also the sports writer. And he says he's sometimes called the man who knows the names of things. And knowing the names of things is important because it helps you distinguish between different species and it helps you spot different characteristics of species. And so hopefully this video will have helped you to distinguish some of the species that are typical in a northern hay meadow. And that's a meadow which it should be prevalent in this area of Scotland and northern England as a whole. So thank you very much for watching. Hopefully you'll be able to identify some of these species in your own gardens.